This letter was on the first nighttime airmail flight from Chicago to New York. It might not seem like a big deal till you realize that was 1925. Hi, I'm Mark Harmon, and on this episode of History Revealed, history authors Ken and Chris Bilderbeck will explore this artifact's mysterious connections to our area and the role that two local pilots played in aviation history.
So we're here today to talk about two airmail pioneers with ties to Washington County, Mark Hoag and James DeWitt Hill, but their roles in aviation history go far beyond that.
Oh, absolutely. And let's start with Mark Hoag. Mark actually was not a native of Washington County. He was born in Nebraska back in 1896. His family didn't move here until 1913 when he enrolled at Forest Grove Union High School. And he was just a star in high school. He was a star student, he was a star athlete, very popular. So much so that he enrolled at Stanford University, which, you know, at the time was probably the premier university on the West Coast. Mm-hmm. And the newspapers followed his exploits even down there just because it was a rarity then. It was somewhat of a rarity to even go to high school back then. So he was a star there, and who knows what he might have accomplished at Stanford, but World War I broke out.
Oh dear.
And like many of his fellow students and people of his age, he joined the military to help with the war effort. But unlike most of his friends and fellow students, he did not go into the infantry or into the Navy, that's what most people did back in World War I. He had dreams of becoming a fighter pilot.
And he was one of the first.
Yes, so much so that the United States didn't even have pilots with combat experience to train these young men who wanted to go over to France and be pilots. So we had to import flight instructors from France in order to teach Mark Hoag and his fellow countrymen how to fly. And fortunately for us, we learned a lot about flight school and the military in general because Mark Hoag was very devoted to his mother and he was an excellent letter writer. And he wrote many letters home to his mother that ended up even being published in the newspaper.
Well, and those letters really give us a window into what his training was like and what his experience was like as an early aviator.
Oh, and you know, just little things. One of the things that touched me in one was when he was in basic training, he was in San Francisco, he was talking about how the various islands in San Francisco Bay, their importance to the military, and he was talking about this exotic island called Alcatraz, which had been created as a prison for the people who tried to go AWOL or desert from the military. Mm. But another one of the stories that I think I like the most is that when he talks about the strict training they were getting and how you got only one test after all your training, you got one test to see if you could make it. And he was determined to make it, and he told his mother that if he did, he would get paid $250 a month.
Well, but that was a princely sum, wasn't it, at the time?
Oh, it was. It definitely was. It was a lot of money. But Mark pointed out to his mother that he had to take into consideration the fact that at that time, fully half of all the pilots died in combat. So he figured he was worth the money.
But Mark did not die in combat.
No, and in fact, he never even saw combat. Because perhaps ironically, he was such a star pilot that the Army Air Corps didn't want to risk losing him in combat. Instead, they kept him stateside to train other pilots.
But his story doesn't end there.
No, his story is really just getting started.
Yeah.
As the war ended, he wanted to keep on flying. And so he signed up to become one of the very first airmail pilots for the post office.
And this was in 1920.
This was in 1920. And airmail doesn't, you know, that seems pretty passe today, but in 1920, this was pretty spectacular. In fact, the pioneers of the airmail service were viewed very much as the first astronauts were viewed a generation later. They became national heroes.
So tell us about some of Mark's exploits.
Well, you know, again, they're flying these missions in propeller airplanes. Open cockpit airplanes with the mail in them, and they try, you know, the post office, their motto about neither rain nor sleet nor snow, they tried to keep that going in with airmail too. So on a couple of occasions, he got caught in really bad weather. One time he got caught in a thunderstorm and had to rise up above the thunderstorm and ran out of gas and had to crash land the plane. He walked away.
Yeah.
Another time he had a crash landing. Once again, he walked away. And so these exploits of his made him sort of a national celebrity, on a small scale at least, because of how daring he was.
Yes.
And so he kept that up for a little while, but then he saw other opportunities.
Which were?
Well, he realized that there were, he maybe make some more money by flying rich people around. So he created one of the first air taxi services. This was back before the day of airlines where you could just go buy a ticket and fly. You hired a pilot, much as you would a taxi cab. So he became a taxi pilot between New York and Boston and quickly met many of the most rich and famous people of the day and became quite the socialite, if you will, in New York City. Now his exploits in the paper included pictures of him with all the beautiful young debutantes of New York City.
I'll bet he was quite attractive to them.
Well.
But then tragedy struck.
Yes. He actually did marry one of the brightest young socialites in New York City, but not long after that, after all the, you know, daring escapes as an airmail pilot, he took off from Boston one day with one of the richest men in Boston as his passenger. For whatever reason, we still don't know, but he crashed head-on into a railroad trestle, and both he and his passenger were killed instantly.
Well, the investigation thought it might have been attributed to a frozen steering stick. But we will never know for sure.
We'll never know. You know, they didn't have the National Transportation Safety Board back then.
Right.
But we do know that on the day he died, his mother, his beloved mother, was back in Forest Grove, was packing to fly to go to New York City, probably on the train, packing to go to New York City to see her son and his new wife. So, you know.
Sad.
It's sad because she did make the trip, but obviously, at that point, it was to attend his funeral.
Well, and that brings us to this artifact, which is a letter from the very first night flight by an airmail pilot, just a couple of months after Mark Hoag's death in 1925.
Yes, and this letter is interesting in its own right because it's addressed to Arthur Litt, who, again, we're talking about names that are forgotten today, but he was quite a famous textile artist of the day and a fine artist as well. So just the fact that he was involved and kept the envelope as a souvenir tells you how significant this was. And the man we're talking about now was one of the first two pilots. This is a picture from one of the first airmail, the first night this letter was on board. This is James DeWitt Hill. And James DeWitt Hill was, at the time, more famous, in fact, than Mark Hoag. He's not a name that we recognize here, but he, like you say, at that time, was quite the celebrity.
But he didn't grow up here.
No, he was like Mark Hoag in another way, in that he came from back east. He was actually born in Pennsylvania. And he was quite a bit older. He was born in, I think it was 1882. And so, as pilots of the day go, he was fairly old. And he didn't even get his start as a pilot until fairly late in life. Because back in Pennsylvania, he was kind of a sickly child. He got his engineering degree at Cornell, but he couldn't fly because his health was too bad. So he went to work for Glenn Curtiss, who was an aviation pioneer, made the Curtiss Jenny that he's probably most famous for, the plane that Mark Hoag flew. And so he went to work as an engineer and then into sales. And he ended up moving out to Oregon, to Portland, to help Glenn Curtiss expand his aviation business to the West Coast.
So explain James DeWitt Hill's connection to Washington County.
Well, he moved to Oregon. He bought a farm out near Gaston in Patton Valley. And this would have been about 1914, I think, something like that. And he, when he moved there, his health just improved dramatically. And we have to remember that one of the main reasons a lot of people moved from the East and the Midwest at that time was for Oregon's climate. It often had a very healthy effect, and he was no exception.
It's quite salubrious.
Salubrious was a word that was often used back then.
Yes.
And was so salubrious for him that he was able to realize his dream of becoming an airline pilot.
And then World War I started.
Yes, World War I started, and like Mark Hogue and so many other people, he wanted to go be a fighter pilot. But while his health was good enough to fly, the Army Air Corps said it still was not good enough to be a fighter pilot or to even enlist. So instead, they hired him as a contract flight instructor. And so while he was never a military veteran, or like Hogue, never got to be a flying ace over in Europe, he did play a very important part in teaching the folks who did go
pilots
over there.
Yeah. So James DeWitt Hill did not achieve fame in the Air Corps. However, he did go on after the war to become one of the early airmail pilots.
Yes, and even then, that's not what he's best remembered for. Because he, back in the day, we're talking about 1927 by now, he was in competition with several other people to become the first pilot to fly across the Atlantic Ocean.
Hmm.
And in fact, a lot of people consider James DeWitt Hill to be the favorite to achieve that first because he had the backing of William Randolph Hearst, who was owned half the newspapers in the country practically and was one of the most wealthy and powerful men in the country. We know, however, you know, we don't need a, this is in fact one of Hearst's newspapers right here, and we don't need that to know that James DeWitt Hill was not in fact the first to fly across the Atlantic. A fellow by the name of Charles Lindbergh, who really was not considered to be one of the top contenders, who was also, by the way, an airmail pilot, but he, of course, ended up making the trip first.
But James DeWitt Hill did not give up.
No, he did not. It's kind of a funny story, but William Randolph Hearst still dreamed of having some sort of record. So he said, we weren't the first, but what we'll do, we'll have the longest flight. Because Lindbergh made it as far as Paris. So Hearst said, we're going to go all the way to Rome. And he figured that would still be enough for fame. So perhaps, you know what, ironically, I guess, we look at Hearst's headline there of Lindbergh's glory. James DeWitt Hill had a plane by the name of Old Glory. And Hearst made sure that everybody knew about Old Glory. He so much so that he said he was going to send his newspaper editor from New York on the flight to chronicle the whole thing, along with yet another of the early airmail pioneers, a fellow by the name of Lloyd Berthaud.
Well, here's Lloyd and James DeWitt Hill right here.
Yes.
And then here is Lloyd and James with the publisher.
Yes, and they were, they made a big deal about the takeoff of this flight and played up the danger of it, and they made a big deal of the editor's wife and Berthaud's wife, you know, seeing off their husbands, their heroic husbands. But they also were trying to build up James DeWitt Hill. And we don't know exactly the motives for this, but the newspaper stories made a major point that he was a bachelor and that he didn't have any young love to see him off. And I think it was to add poignancy to that sort of thing. But, you know, they tried to create him in him even more pathos, I suppose, than
might have helped sell newspapers.
I suspect that was the...
Well, but there were actually quite a few parallels between Hogue and Hill, and sadly, tragedy was one of those things that they both had in common.
Yes, because the flight of Old Glory got postponed several times because of weather. It was not ideal flying conditions, but it was still a big deal. They ended up moving it to a beach in Maine, of all places, to take off, because there were only a few, Roosevelt Field was where Lindbergh had taken off in New York, and that's where James DeWitt Hill wanted to, but they couldn't because of the weather. There were no other airports at that point capable of handling his plane, so they had to find this wide beach in Maine to take off. And they did, and they took off successfully. And again, just to add a little drama to the whole thing, they had a radio on board, and Lloyd Bertaud's wife had learned to operate the radio to help monitor the flight. And so, sadly, she was the one who heard their distress call, because they didn't get too far out over the Atlantic before, they were just not too far off the coast of Newfoundland, before something went wrong and the plane disappeared.
They called the Mayday.
They called the Mayday, but they went down.
So, sadly, that was a fate pretty common for aviation pioneers of that era.
Yes, and you know, in some ways, he was almost luckier than others, because at the time, a number of the people trying to fly across the Atlantic disappeared, and typically, there's never a trace found. And while they never found the bodies of James DeWitt Hill or Lloyd Bertaud or Hearst's editor, they were able to find a few weeks later enough of the wreckage of Old Glory out in the ocean to
know what happened.
To know what happened.
Well, so what happened to the farm back in Washington County?
Well, this is where all the publicity about how James DeWitt Hill was a bachelor and had no one to love him. A short while later, you found this little tidbit in a newspaper from Forest Grove, just a small tidbit about how the widow of James DeWitt Hill had sold the farm in Patton Valley and moved away. And that was the end of James DeWitt Hill's connection to Washington County.
But the newspaper didn't lie. It turns out they had actually separated.
Yes.
But never divorced.
Right. So. At least that's apparently what we know now.
What we know.
And so ends our story of two men who were giants among early pilots. Like their colleague Charles Lindbergh, Mark Hogue and James DeWitt Hill used their experience as airmail pilots to rise to national fame. Unlike Lucky Lindy, they never lived to see old age. Please join us again for the next episode of History Revealed.